Hi friends, I welcome you all to Developing Success. In today's video, I shall be discussing about the land revenue system, the difference between Zamindari, Rayotwadi and Mehelwadi system. And those of you who will be giving prelims or mains this time, maybe there is a possibility that there might be a question from Rayotwadi as it is completing its 200 years. The system of Rayotwadi draws back to 1820 and in 2020 it completes its 200 years. So it will be an important topic, might be for this year. See, when I talk about land revenue, I will firstly talk about the current scenario, the present. At present, there is no state government who is levying taxes on the farmers. There is no central government or there is no act through which central government can collect taxes from the farmers. So the agriculture income is exempted in India. However, before independence, the chief source of revenue was agriculture income, which the Britishers used to call it as land revenue. So land revenue is a kind of tax levied on the agriculture produce of a land which was collected by the monarchs and the kings and later by the British. Yes, we do have evidences that since the ancient times, even during the Vedic time, there were incidences where the monarchs used to collect land tax. However, in independent India, no land revenue is collected by either state or the central government. So as you all are aware that the Britishers who came in India in 1608 in the pretext of East India Company, they were engaged in commercial activities, but gradually they became the political class in India and they started ruling over a fixed territory in India, and as a result they started collecting land tax and land revenue became the chief source of income for the British. As in this table below, you see this British jackstay. And I have written that the land revenue collected through different systems like Zamindari, Rayotwadi and Mehelwadi, and second was the commercial activities. So the first major source was land revenue. Now let us talk about the present. At present, neither the central nor the state government is collecting any kind of land tax. However, some state governments, they are collecting tax, they are collecting stamp duty, not tax rather, registry fees, stamp duty on sale or purchase of land and property. So the chief source of revenue for the central government is corporation tax, income tax, CGST. For the state government, it is SGST, VAT, excise on liquor and fuel, and stamp duties. So when we talk about the land revenue system before the British era, we have evidences that from the Vedic times, the kings of the Mahajanpadas used to levy land tax, which was called as Bali. So it is not a new thing, and it was one of the chief source of revenue. It went on for years and years, even in the time of British era. Some efforts in, you know, measuring the land, how much should be the land tax, was done by Sikandar Lodi in medieval times. And the thing what Sikandar Lodi had done, it will be followed by Shershah Suri, and then it will be also followed by Akbar. Then the land revenue system will be changed during the time of Britishers. So over the years, the chief source of income was land revenue for different kings and dynasty. However, the ownership pattern varied from period to period and dynasty to dynasty. In medieval India, Sikandar Lodi had attempted to regulate land revenue, measure the land. In fact, he had also constituted a land measuring unit called as Sikandri Gaz. Ladies and gentlemen, in North India, when we go to North India, so we get properties like there are flats to sell. So we say 100 gaj ka plot hai, 200 gaj ka plot hai. Like in South India, it is the unit is used as cent, but in North India, the unit is used as gaj. So this gaj word was constituted by Sikandar Lodi, and it was then used, the same unit was used by Shershah Suri, who was actually successful in measuring the whole land of his empire by the help of Raja Todarmal. So here, the productive and concrete efforts, very important, the productive, he was successful in doing it. The productive and the concrete efforts of measuring the entire land of North India was undertaken by Shershah Suri. he appointed Raja Todarmal for measuring the cultivable and the uncultivable land for his kingdom. See, Shersha Suri was for a very short duration, but he was a great visionary. Whatever short span of region he had done wonders. The GT road, the Grand Trunk Road, rupee as currency was all introduced by Shersha Suri. So he had successfully measured the land of his empire, and he was of the opinion that the tax for agriculture land or for fertile land should be different from land which is barren, which cannot be cultivated. He very importantly had introduced the term patta or kabulat or kabuliyat, which was actually a document. Even today, you know, the word patwadi, it came from patta. So at patta work, you know, they were big pads in which the details were giving. He is the owner, this is the description of the land. And even today, the tehsildar, the SDMs, they're operating by seeing this katta and kabuliyats. So that this terminology was also introduced by Shersha Suri. So later, when after Shersha Suri, Himayu came. Himayu was for a very short duration, and then Akbar came. Now Akbar also stressed on land revenue system, but his most of his land revenue system was same of Shersha Suri. He had brought two major changes. The land revenue system under Mughal was developed by Akbar, but the system was based on Shersha Suri's system. Akbar had brought two major changes in the land revenue system, which were implemented by Raja or Diwan Todarmal. These were standardization of land measurement and fixation of tax rate. Now, there was a standard unit by Sikandar Lodi, that was gaj. In some areas, the gaj was of 32 inches. In some areas, it was of 40 inches. So, there was no one standard unit of that. And second, the rates used to fluctuate every year. Every year, like our budget, the income tax rate is fluctuated. Similarly, every year, the amount of tax or the amount of land revenue to be levied varied. So Akbar had attempted to solve these two things. Akbar had implemented standardization of land measuring unit. He made Ilahi Gaz. So important hai, Sikandri Gaz kisne banaya? Sikandar Lodi. Who had utilized it? Sikandar Lodi and Shersha Suri. The term Ilahi Gaj was coined by Akbar. He made Ilahi Gaj as standard unit of measuring the land. Ilahi Gaj was 32 inches exact, whereas Sikandri Gaj, it varied from 32 inches to 40 inches. Normally 39 inches was there. Before Akbar, revenue settlement of the tax rate were decided and implemented on annual basis. Annual basis means on yearly basis it was decided what will be the tax. And it was a very cumbersome process. Again, things will come up to the Mughal court. This is the fertile land. This is the produce. So he said it's a very cumbersome process. So he made the settlement for 10 years. Thus, there was a variation in tax rate every year. Akbar scrapped it. And he introduced a settlement based on 10 years. Till 10 years, there will be no fluctuation in the rate. So the farmers can also do a long-term planning. This system was called as the Sala system because it was 10 years, the Sal or the Zapti system. Then later we have seen that the Britishers came, but they were they had set up their first town in Madras, but they were not a real political class. The real territorial gain or the real political entity they gained was after Battle of Buxar. The Battle of Buxar, which was fought in October 1764 between Shah Alam and Nawab of Awadh. And after that, Robert Clive was invited again to India to do the ceasefire and to do the peace talks. As a result, after Battle of Buxar, the British had signed Treaty of Allahabad in 1765 with Mughal Emperors Shah Alam and Nawab of Awadh. Those of you who have not seen the previous videos of later Mughals should see this, then only you will be able to understand or connect with this video. Through this treaty, the British got the Diwani rights, the right to for collection of revenue of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa. Robert Clive, the governor of Bengal, implemented the dual system of government, where revenue collected was the responsibility of Deputy Diwan and collected revenue will be deposited to the East India Company. See, after the Treaty of Allahabad, the English got the Diwani rights, that is the right of collecting revenue of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa. But Robert Clive, he did not make the Britishers directly collect the revenue. A, he did not have so much of resources. The East India Company that time did not have so many officers. So he appointed those officers of the previous Nawab to collect the revenue and deposit it to the East India Company. And those officers were called, given the designation of Deputy Diwan. So the Deputy Diwan, they collected the taxes on the behalf of the British and they deposited in the East India Company. My mistake. So then after Robert Clive, Warren Hastings came, but Robert Clive had implemented dual system. One was collection of revenue and other was Nizamat. It was a miserable failure. So Warren Hastings, the new governor of Bengal, he had removed the dual system and he also attempted to do land reforms. So let us see. In 1772, Warren Hastings ended the dual system of government and had introduced quinquennial system or the Isredar system with following features. Warren Hastings declared that the whole land belongs to the state government and the farmers and zamindars were deprived from their ownership rights. So suddenly the government says that the property you own is belonging to the government, you don't own it. So what a mockery. The land was auctioned or leased for the period of 5 years to the highest bidder, and the bidder will be responsible for depositing land revenue to the district collector. So whatever what happened, that they said, okay, now no zamindar, no peasant, they will not be the owner, we are the owners, so you have to take the land on lease from us, and the lease will be the maximum tax. Any bidder who promises to pay maximum tax will be given that land for the purpose of cultivation. So there was auction used to happen and people used to bid different rates, but this system was not successful because after 5 years, when the revenue needs to be deposited, the most of the contractor or the most of the persons who were responsible to collect the revenue, they became absconding, they ran away. So quinquennial system was a miserable failure. And from 1776, it was replaced by annual settlement system, where again land was auctioned to the highest bidder, that is the Isredar, on yearly basis. In 1793, Lord Cornwallis had replaced the annual settlement system into permanent settlement system or the Zamindari system. So in 1793, it was the major step, a major step which Lord Cornwallis had taken, that he said it is a very cumbersome process that every year you are auctioning the land and the farmer or the zamindar, they don't know what will be their future, so they don't used to do any future planning. As a result, the settlement is also less, the revenue is also less, and there is every year there is a cumbersome process to again auction of the land. So he said, no, we will be going with the permanent settlement system, that is called the zamindari system. So very importantly, remember, in 1793, Lord Cornwallis had replaced the annual settlement system into permanent settlement system or the zamindari system. So ladies and gentlemen, in front of you, you have the map. Please imagine, that time the Bangladesh and Pakistan were not there. Bangladesh and Pakistan were the part of India. See, 19% of the area had zamindari system. Then we shall be talking about the Rayotwadi system. The maximum area of the British India was under the Rayotwadi system, some part of Assam, Bombay Presidency, the Madras Presidency, and areas of the Uttar Pradesh, Punjab, Haryana. You can see the Punjab of पाकिस्तान ऑल्सो देयर महलवाड़ी सिस्टम वॉज इम्प्लीमेंटेड. सो लेट अस टॉक अबाउट द परमानेंट सेटलमेंट सिस्टम दैट इज द जमींदारी सिस्टम. द परमानेंट सेटलमेंट सिस्टम वॉज ऑल्सो नोन एज जागीरदारी और बेसवादारी सिस्टम. इन दिस सिस्टम जमींदारी द जमींदार द लैंडलॉर्ड्स वर गिवन द ओनरशिप ऑफ द लैंड. दे वर फ्री टू सेल इट, दे वर फ्री टू लीज इट, दे वर फ्री टू मोर्टगेज इट. द जमींदार्स हैड द हेरिडेटरी राइट सो दे कैन ट्रांसफर द लैंड इन द नेम ऑफ देयर चिल्ड्रन ऑल्सो. नाउ वॉट यूज टू हैपन, द जमींदार नाउ ही इज द परमानेंट ओनर ऑफ द लैंड and he will collect the taxes. Suppose he collects 100 rupees, 89% of it he will deposit it to the government and 11 rupees he will keep it with himself. So zamindar will be responsible to collect the tax and deposit 89% of the revenue collected with the district collector. So there is no direct interaction of the British with the peasants, with the farmer who is doing the farming at the ground level. There is a middleman, that is the zamindars, the landlords. The Lord Cornwallis, who had introduced this system, thought it will be practically possible to collect taxes from zamindar and do settlement with them. The British officials lacked sufficient experience in directly making settlement with the farmer or the ryot. So this was the opinion of the Lord Cornwallis. So originally he wanted that it should be for 10 years, but in 1793 he said let the settlement be forever. He made it permanent. So in 1790 the policy of land settlement with the zamindar was for the period of 10 years, but in 1793 it was made permanent. And secondly, the amount of revenue to be collected, that what will be the amount of revenue, what will be the tax rate, it was fixed forever. It was 2 crore 68 lakhs. So initially English thought it is a very win-win situation for them, but in gradual years when agriculture developed, when things happened, so they were not able to change the or increase the revenue. So till independence they were only paid 2 crore 68 lakhs from these areas. So it was a big financial loss in long run for the Britishers. The amount of revenue to be collected was fixed on the financial year 1790-91, where the amount was collected was 2 crore 68 lakhs, and it was decided till forever the Britishers will be paid this amount. So it was a major loss for the Britishers in long run. So I have consolidated the advantages and disadvantages of the zamindari system for the East India Company. So let us talk about the advantages. The system of revenue collection provided East India Company a fixed and a stable income. It was fixed, so every year you will get this much income. The zamindars were responsible to deposit the revenue annually in all circumstances, whether drought is there or flood is there. By introducing permanent settlement, East India Company created a loyal class, that were the zamindars. These zamindars remained loyal at all times. They did not participate in the revolt of 1857. And they did not participate in any British activities. In fact, zamindars didn't wanted that Britishers should go away, because they knew when the Britishers will go away, there will be a day that the government will be taking their excess of land and might be distributing the land to the landless farmer in order to fulfill its socio-economic responsibility. The company was saved from the expense of periodical assessment and settlements. And the major disadvantage, what I have already spoken, is financially the East India Company has proved to be a greater loss in long run. Initially, when the permanent settlement was introduced, the revenue fixed annually was quite high, but gradually in the subsequent years the zamindari started earning much more, and the revenue to be deposited with the British was a meager, was pennies. Now, the advantages of zamindari system to the Indians: zamindars, seeing their permanent interest encouraged for agriculture techniques, waste land was brought under cultivation. better use of manure and other techniques were put into the practice. In fact, it is very important to understand one more thing, that the zamindars, some of the zamindars, they had made canals, the irrigation canals also, because now they were seeing their permanent interest in that land. It was not auctioned every year. The disadvantage to the Indians, the biggest disadvantage was that it created feudalism in India. The biggest disadvantage of the zamindari system was it started feudalism in India. It created a system of exploitation and oppression. This had resulted into feudals at the top and the serfdom at the bottom. You had created a class. You have divided the society into two stratas. One will be the landlord, who is a feudal lord. And second is a serfdom, who is the service class, who is actually putting his efforts, who is doing the hard work at the grounds. That is the farmer. The position of the farmer or the ryot became worse. A large number of intermediaries grow, and the ryot had to sell his agriculture produce to the intermediaries at a low cost, and they made huge profit when they sold it into urban markets. See, the farmers now didn't have the resources that he could carry the crops or the agriculture produce to the urban markets or to the mandis. So he used to sell it to the mahajans or the intermediary. So as a result, the middlemen used to earn lot of profit. In a way, the peasants suffered from a double injustice. First, by surrendering their property rights, and secondly, by entirely they were at the mercy of the zamindars. So, you know, zamindars also maintained their small police, something like that, their hooligans, their gundas, who used to ransack the house of the farmer if the rent is not paid at time. And though the Britishers did not increase, it was a permanent settlement, the Britishers did not increase the rent or the tax, but the zamindars, they used to frequently increase the rent of the land which they had leased out to the farmer. Now let us understand the ryotwari system. Ryotwari is direct collection from the farmer. In one shot, direct collection from the farmer. Zamindari, direct collection from the zamindar, the middlemen, the feudal lords. The term ryot means peasant in Persian language. Under this system, the East India Company did direct settlement with the ryot, the peasant. The peasant was directly responsible to deposit revenue earned from agriculture produce. Ryot or the peasant was recognized as the owner of the land with perpetual rights. Here the farmer was independent. He was able to sell his land. He was able to mortgage his land. So the land on which he is doing the farming, it belongs to the farmer. The owner of the land is farmer. There were many shortcomings of the permanent settlement. A, that the revenue was fixed. So there was no scope of increasing or having any fluctuation in the revenue. So a lot of people were opposing the zamindari system after its imposition. So the second system which came in India was ryotwari system, which was implemented in at least 51% of the area of India. Then what had happened that Lord Cornwallis, John Shore came, and then in 1798 Lord Wellesley came, who himself used to call himself as Bengal Tiger. He followed a policy of aggression and war, and he made subsidiary alliance popular, and as a result, to a great extent, majority of the areas was made a part of British Empire, and it belonged to the British India. So there was a huge territory. So there was a need for one more land revenue settlement or one more land revenue system. So zamindari was not like, so the other thing was ryotwari. So in 1820, Thomas Munro, the governor of Madras, propounded the ryotwari system. Seeing the success of this settlement, soon it was introduced to other parts of the India. After the third Anglo-Maratha War, 1816 to 1818, the governor of Bombay, Alphonstein, submitted a report of Maratha areas acquired from the last Peshwa and recommended to impose ryotwari system in the Bombay province. So is it very clear? Now we shall be discussing about the Mehelwari system. See, Mehel. महल डज नॉट मीन हियर अ पैलेस. महल इज नॉट दैट रॉयल मैनचेस्टर रॉयल पैलेस रॉयल मैशन. इट इज हियर इट मीन्स अ स्टेट. स्टेट व्हाट डू यू मीन बाई स्टेट? अ लार्ज एरिया और अ विलेज यू कैन सी. सो अंडर दिस सिस्टम द यूनिट फॉर रेवेन्यू सेटलमेंट इज द विलेज. रिमेंबर जमींदार द लैंडलॉर्ड, रियोतवाड़ी द फार्मर, महलवाड़ी द विलेज और विलेज ऑफ द महल. सो द विलेज लैंड बिलोंग्स जॉइंटली टू द विलेज कम्युनिटी एंड द इंडिविजुअल. द विलेज कलेक्टिवली एंड द इंडिविजुअल आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल टू पे रेवेन्यू. हॉल्ट मैकेंजी द सेक्रेटरी टू द बोर्ड ऑफ कमीशन ऑफ रेवेन्यू हैड रिकमेंडेड सर्वे ऑफ लैंड एंड प्रिपरेशन ऑफ रिकॉर्ड ऑफ राइट्स ऑफ लैंड village by village or mahal by mahal and collection of revenue through the village headman. The regulation of 1822 gave a legal sanction to the recommendation of Holt Mackenzie. However, this system was put in practice in 1833. Initially, the state or the East India Company demanded 66% of the net produce, yani 2/3, but in later days, in 1855, Lord Dalhousie had enacted Saharanpur rules through which it was reduced to 50%. This was one of the good thing what Lord Cornwallis, Lord Dalhousie did, because Dalhousie in context to history, he is famous for doctrine of lapse and famous of inciting the princely class and one of the major cause of revolt of 1857. So let us see the advantages of Royatwadi and Mahalwadi system and the disadvantages. The settlement was not permanent but for a fixed tenure of 30 years. Unlike Zamindari system where it was for permanent, you have to pay 2 crore 68 lakhs for n years. So till independence the amount was same. Thus in after every 30 years here the government can increase or decrease the rate. The revenue under Royatwadi and Mahalwadi was much more than the Zamindari system. Obviously, it was fixed to 2 crore 68 lakhs. Maybe it is 10% by the time of 1855. The government had direct touch with the peasants and the village community. Under Mahalwadi system, an additional benefit was enjoyed by the East India Company that revenue was collected from a single person, that is the village headman, which was easier and cheaper for the government. Now, the disadvantages. There were much benefits than the disadvantages to the company. See, the Royatwadi and Mahalwadi was brought because Zamindari was not successful. So the Britishers had worked on all the disadvantages of Zamindari system. The only major disadvantage to the company was these systems failed to create a loyal class as compared to the Zamindari system where landlords remained loyal to the British. So let us see the advantages and disadvantages to the Indians. First, the peasants were saved from the oppression and tyranny of the zamindars. The second advantage was the peasants were the owner of the land, thus they could sell their land or mortgage it. The disadvantage, the land revenue was collected on the basis of net produce, but it was practically difficult to estimate. Now what happens, I don't know how many of you have done some business or something like that. See, net income is different, gross income is different. Gross income is sales, but if we reduce our expenses from it, then it is net income. Suppose you are having a shop, you are only considering the sales, you are not considering the input of electricity, you are not considering the input of rent, then it will not show you the net income. So the problem, the biggest problem in Royatwadi and Mahalwadi system was that our farmers were not so much educated that time, and that time we did not had the farmers were not able to keep justified records to the revenue department that this was their expenses. Like even today when we calculate our income tax, we deduct all the all the exemptions, all our medical expenses and other things. That time the farmer was not able to do so. So land revenue was collected on the basis of net produce, but it was practically difficult to estimate the total cost incurred in the productivity act, as it was difficult to maintain records of expenditure of manure, animals, etc. Thus, in reality, land revenue was levied on total sale produce. So high rate of are you getting this point? And the second is, high rate of revenue forced the peasants to take loan from money lenders like Mahajan. The rate of interest was quite high and arbitrary, which made it difficult for the peasants to settle his loan account. The British police and the judicial system also favored the Mahajans. Police ko jo paisa dega bhai uski kahin bar police baat karti hai, that is the same thing. During the days of American Civil War, the Bombay province witnessed Deccan riots due to this issue. This particular topic I will explain you in the upcoming videos. Deccan riots is something very important, and it had a direct relation with American Civil War. Right now I will just explain you when there was a civil war going in America. So the Britishers, all the textile mills like the Manchester's, they started importing raw cotton from India. So people in Maharashtra, the Bombay Presidency, they were seeing a large profit in this, and they started taking loans from the Mahajan so that they can do the agriculture of the cotton. But after the civil war got ended, so again the Britishers, they started resuming the supplies from cotton from America. As a result, the cotton supplies from India was reduced, and the people did not earn profit, and they were not able to repay their loans, which resulted into Deccan riots. So in this table I had, this is a very important table, you can click it, you can you have to summarize it, you have to rectify this. This is a very important table. It gives you exactly what is Zamindari, Rayotwadi and Mehelwadi system. The Zamindari system started in 1793, Rayotwadi 1820, Mehelwadi 1822. Main propounder, Lord Cornwallis, Governor General of Bengal, Thomas Monroe, the Governor of Bengal, Hald Mackenzie, Member Board of Commission of Revenue. Now, who will pay the tax, Zamindar or the landlord? Zamindar will collect it from the peasants and deposit 89% of the collected tax, and rest 11% will be left for the zamindars. Here in this system, the East India Company will directly collect the revenue from the peasant or the farmer. There is no middleman. The word mehel refers to the estate or a village. The headman will collect the taxes from the peasant. What is the settlement amount? It was fixed throughout from all the zamindars, 2 crore 68 lakhs. Here initially it was 66%, later it was reduced to 50%, and it was on net produce. It was not fixed, it was net produce. So suppose in 1850 the net produce is somewhere 3 crores, maybe in 1880 it is 5 crores, so they will get 50% of it. The settlement tenure permanent, 30 years 30 years. Owner of the land, zamindar, peasant and peasant. Hope you all have got the difference between zamindari, Rayotwadi and Mehelwadi. And the last thing, how did zamindari system got abolished? See, the Britishers, they also took cognizance that it is an injustice caused by the peasants. They were aware that how zamindars were acting, and they were also not very happy with the zamindars because it was a loss making venture for them, since the settlement was permanent. So thus British attempted twice in 1859 and 1885 to pass tenancy legislation to protect the interest of peasants, but somehow zamindars managed to evade this legislation. Finally, after independence, government had passed the State Government of West Bengal, the West Bengal Acquisition of Estates Act, which had been abolished the zamindari system by paying compensation by giving them some amount, some compensation to the zamindars at a huge expense of exchequer. It is a very similar step, like you remember Sardar Vallabhai Patel, when he was able to ensure that the princely states, they joined the Indian Union. So once the princely state, they signed the instrument of accession, they were promised to give some kind of pension or some kind of money from Government of India for surrendering their property and their kingdom to Government of India. In similar manner, Government of West Bengal also paid compensation to the zamindars after acquiring their land, so that redistribution of land can be done. So lot of land ceiling acts will be coming up. So the in fact the framers of the Indian Constitution gave the subject of land resource under Schedule 7 to the state governments. Thus the state government enacted various land ceiling act. However, these acts were again and again challenged in various courts. Thus Parliament enacted Schedule 9 of the Indian Constitution through the first Constitutional Amendment Act to safeguard these legislations or laws of the state government. See, in various states the Land Ceiling Act was there, that no person could buy more than 100 acres of land. I am giving you an example. So any property, anyone who is holding more than 100 acres, it was acquired by the state government. But there was something called as Article 31, that is right to property. So people, the zamindars whose lands were confiscated, used to go to the High Court and Supreme Court telling that their fundamental rights are being violated by the state. So as a result, Supreme Court or the High Courts or the they used to give some respite to the zamindars. So as a result, the judiciary had again and again questioned the constitutionality of the land ceiling acts by the state government. So in order to keep the judiciary or to keep the land ceiling acts away from the judicial review, government of India, the parliament had enacted Schedule 9, where they have kept all the land ceiling acts so that it is protected from the judicial scrutiny. Then there was Acharya Vinoba Bhave, who was greatly influenced by Mahatma Gandhi's Sarvodaya movement, which is a socio-economic movement, and he started a movement called as Bhudan. Bhudan means Bhumi ka Daan, gift of land, in 1951 in the Telangana region, when the state of Hyderabad, when the Hyderabad of Nizam was made a part of India. So large land holdings were there with few of the zamindars. So he peacefully protested and peacefully persuaded them that the large land holders should give their lands to the landless farmers. Hope you are able to understand this. Any doubts, you can please mention it in the comment section. And I hope you have good time. Please study hard, do perform well. Bye dear.